Today's topic is touch, temperature and proprioception. It is included under competency number PY 10.3, containing with the sensory system. Today I will be telling you very briefly the different receptors of touch, temperature and proprioception and how these sensory modalities are perceived in our body, the pathway through which these sensations are carried from the receptors to the brain. So basically, touch, temperature, proprioception, all these are somatic sensations. Somatic sensations include sensations of touch, pressure, vibration, stereognosis, then proprioception, temperature, and pain. You'll be having a separate class on pain, where the pathway of pain and all the related things will be told to you. Proprioception is considered a specialized variation of the sensory modality of touch and encompasses the sensations of joint position and joint movement. And this sensation of joint movement is also known as kinesthesia. Coming to the touch, pressure, and vibration sensation. Touch, pressure, and vibration are considered to be different forms of the same sensation. These sensory modalities are at first appreciated by receptors, which are collectively termed as mechanoreceptors. So as you know, for any sensations to be perceived at first, it has to be perceived through the sensory receptors. The sensory receptors carry this information and then this information is carried through a pathway to the brain, and then we perceive the sensation. So the receptors which appreciate this touch, pressure and vibration, they are collectively known as mechanoreceptors. They provide information about touch, pressure and vibration stimuli to skin. These include Meissner's corpuscle, Merkel's disc, Ruffini end organs, Pacinian corpuscle, free nerve endings, hair and organs. So Meissner's corpuscles, they are located in the upper dermis. They are rapidly adapting receptors and responds to low frequency vibrations and fine touch. So these are the receptors for fine touch and low frequency vibrations. Then Merkel's disc, they are located at the base of epidermis. They are slowly adapting receptors which respond to sustained touch and pressure. Ruffini endings, they are located deep in dermis and hypodermis. They are slow adapting receptors which are sensitive to skin stretch and respond to sustained pressure. Pacinian corpuscles, they are located deep in dermis. They are rapidly adapting receptors that respond to deep pressure and high frequency vibrations. Free nerve endings, they are located around hair follicles throughout the skin. They carry the sensation of light touch, hot, cold, and pain. So this diagram shows the location of the different receptors. So you can see this Meissner's corpuscles, they are lying in the dermis. Then this Merkel's disc, they are located just below the epidermis. Pacinian corpuscles, then Ruffini end organs, they are located in the dermis. The free nerve endings, they are located in the epidermis around the hair follicles. The parts of the body showing highest concentration of touch receptors are the lips, fingertips, tip of nose, etc. And these areas are highly sensitive to touch. In areas such as back, sole of foot, calf region, the receptors are less in number, hence less sensitive to touch. So you should know the distribution of the receptors. That is, the receptors are more in the lips, fingertips, tip of nose, and hence these areas are very sensitive to touch, whereas the number of receptors are very less in the back, in the sole of foot, calf region, and hence these areas are less sensitive to touch. Now let's see what are the fibers involved. The fibers carrying touch sensation are mostly grouped to sensory fibers A beta, which carry impulse at higher speed. Some C fibers are also involved in carrying touch sensation. Touch sensation from some hair follicle receptor is carried by A delta fibers. Now let's see the pathways for touch, pressure, and vibration. The sensation of touch is carried by the following pathways: anterospinothalamic tract or the anterolateral system. Then dorsal column, medial lemniscal system, or posterior column, or tracts of Gall and Burdock. And the touch sensation from face and related structure is carried by trigeminal nerve. The anterior spinothalamic tract carries sensation for crude touch and pressure. The lateral spinothalamic tract carries sensation of temperature and pain. So this anterior spinothalamic tract and lateral spinothalamic tract, in a combined way, we say it as anterolateral spinothalamic tract. So you should remember the anterior spinothalamic tract carries sensations for crude touch and pressure. Crude touch and pressure is through anterior spinothalamic tract, and the lateral spinothalamic tract carries sensation of temperature and pain. The dorsal column lemniscal system carries the following sensations: fine touch, sense of vibration, tactile localization, two-point discrimination, stereognosis, proprioception. So we can see that regarding the touch, the crude touch is through the anterior spinothalamic tract, whereas the fine touch is through the dorsal column lemniscal system. Temperature is carried through the lateral spinothalamic tract. Then pressure is carried through the anterior spinothalamic tract. Then tactile localization, two-point discrimination, and sense of vibration, all these are carried through the dorsal column lemniscal system. And stereognosis, what is stereognosis? It is the ability to perceive different objects with the help of our hand by feeling their texture. Okay, so that is the stereognosis. So stereognosis is also, the sensation of stereognosis is also carried through the dorsal column lemniscal system. Coming to the anterior spinothalamic pathway. Anterolateral system carries crude touch. Both A beta and C fibers carrying touch sensation enter through posterior nerve roots, whose cell bodies are situated in the dorsal root ganglion. So this is the dorsal root ganglion. So through this posterior root, the A beta and C fibers carrying sensation from the receptors enter the dorsal root ganglion. The neurons at the dorsal root ganglion constitute the first order neurons. So the neurons which are in the dorsal root ganglion, they are the first order neurons. They are also known as primary sensory neuron. They receive the stimulus at the receptor associated to it and release the impulse to the next order. And the first order neuron relay the impulse to the next order neurons. The fibers of first order neurons pass through the medial division of the root into the posterior horn of spinal gray matter. So see here, they enter the posterior horn of the spinal gray matter. Here the fibers relay and the second order neurons start. So this is the first order neurons. From here, they come into the posterior horn of the spinal gray matter and they relay here. And from here, from the posterior gray horn of the spinal cord, the second order neurons start. So this second order neurons, they cross to the opposite side. Okay. The fibers of the second order neurons then ascend in the anterior funiculus. This is the anterior funiculus. This is the lateral funiculus. Okay. So they cross and enter the anterior funiculus of the spinal cord as the anterior spinothalamic tract. So this is the anterior spinothalamic tract. So basically these fibers enter the anterior funiculus. If these fibers enter into the lateral funiculus, then it will be known as lateral spinothalamic tract. Basically anterior spinothalamic tract and lateral spinothalamic tract, basics is same, only the thing is that here the fibers of the second order neurons ascend into the anterior funiculus in the anterior spinothalamic tract, and in the lateral spinothalamic tract these fibers will enter into the lateral funiculus of the spinothalamic tract of the spinal cord. The tract continues in the brain stem with the medial lemniscus and in the ventral posterolateral nucleus of the thalamus. So they ascend upwards, okay, and they continue up to the ventral posterolateral nucleus of the thalamus. Posterolateral nucleus of the thalamus, where from the third order neurons start. From here, the third order neurons will start. From the thalamus, the fibers pass through the internal capsule to the sensory cortex. So third order neurons start from the posterolateral nucleus of the thalamus. And from here, it radiates to the sensory cortex. Okay. So this is the first order, then this is the second order neurons. Okay. Then they will relay here. From here, the third order neurons start. So first order, second order, then third order neurons. And finally, these fibers reach the area 3-1-2 of the Brodmann. This is the sensory cortex. Area 3-1-2 of the Brodmann. Sensory cortex. Coming to the dorsal column or medial lemniscal system, which is also known as posterior column or tracts of Gall and Burdock. The lemniscal system carries fine touch, vibration sense, and proprioception. The A beta fibers carrying touch sensation from Merkel's disc, Meissner's corpuscle, hair bulb endings, and also from some free nerve endings enter through the posterior root. The cell body situated at the dorsal root ganglion have long axons. The fibers from the primary sensory neurons enter the spinal cord and ascend through the posterior funiculus. The tract of Gall, fasciculus gracilis, is composed of fibers from the coccygeal, sacral, lumbar, and lower thoracic ganglia. And the tract of Burdock, fasciculus cunetus, which lies laterally, consists of fibers from upper thoracic and cervical ganglia. In the medulla, the fibers relay in the nucleus gracilis and nucleus cunetus, where from the second order neurons start. So, from the nucleus gracilis and nucleus cunetus, the second order neurons start. The fibers of the second order neurons cross to the opposite side. So from dorsal root and spinal ganglion, this is the first order neurons. Okay, first order neurons. Then from here, the second order neurons start. The second order neurons cross to the opposite side. They cross to the opposite side through the sensory decussation and form the medial lemniscus. Hence, this pathway is also named as dorsal column medial lemniscal system. The medial lemniscus continues upwards and ends in the ventral posterolateral nucleus of thalamus. So in the thalamus, the second order neuron ends. So from here, the medial lemniscal system starts and ends in the thalamus. And from the thalamus, the third order neurons start. Fibers from thalamus proceed through the internal capsule to end in the sensory cortex, that is area 3-1-2 of the Brodmann. So they also finally relate to the sensory cortex. So this is the dorsal column or lemniscal system. First order neurons, they come up from here. The second order neurons, they cross to the opposite side. They cross to the opposite side through the sensory decussation. And finally, they form the lemniscal system and terminate in the thalamus. From here, the third order neurons start and they finally relay into the sensory cortex. Through trigeminal nerve, the face and some other structures are innervated by the trigeminal nerve. The cell bodies of the primary sensory neurons are situated in the trigeminal ganglion. The central processes of these neurons end on the second order neurons in the principal sensory nucleus of the trigeminal nerve in the pons. These second order neurons cross to the opposite side to end in the contralateral thalamus. Coming to the temperature sensation, thermal receptors and their excitation. The human being can perceive different gradations of cold and heat, from freezing cold, to cool, to warm, to hot, to burning hot. Thermal gradations are discriminated by at least three types of sensory receptors: cold receptors, warmth receptors, and pain receptors. The cutaneous receptors, which respond to the temperature change, are situated in the subcutaneous tissue because the change in the subcutaneous temperature indicates whether the body is losing or gaining heat. The cold and warmth receptors are located immediately under the skin at discrete, separated spots. Most areas of the body have 3 to 10 times as many cold spots as warm spots. The pain receptors are stimulated only by extreme degrees of heat or cold, and therefore are responsible for freezing cold and burning hot sensations. Stimulation of thermal receptors: sensations of cold, cool, indifferent, warm, and hot. So you can see here, this is the temperature and this is the impulses per second. So at temperatures of 5 to 10, freezing cold, the cold pain receptors are stimulated. Then from 15 to around 40, this cold receptors are stimulated. Then the warm receptors are stimulated from temperature of 30 to 50. And above 45, the heat pain receptors are stimulated. In the very cold region, only the cold pain fibers are stimulated. As the temperature rises to 10 degrees Celsius to 15 degrees Celsius, the cold receptors begin to be stimulated. Above about 30 degrees Celsius, the warm receptors begin to be stimulated. At around 45 degrees Celsius, the heat pain fibers begin to be stimulated by heat. And paradoxically, some of the cold fibers begin to be stimulated again, possibly because of damage to the cold endings caused by the excessive heat. A person determines the different gradations of thermal sensation by the relative degrees of stimulation of the different types of endings. Thus, extreme degrees of both cold and heat can be painful. Also, freezing cold and burning hot sensation feel almost alike. Coming to the mechanism of stimulation of thermal receptors, the cold and warmth receptors are stimulated by changes in their metabolic rates. These changes result from the fact that temperature alters the rate of intracellular chemical reactions more than twofold for each 10 degree change. So, if there is a change of 10 degrees Celsius, if it increases to, suppose from 30 to 40, then the rate of intracellular chemical reactions will increase twice. So thus, thermal detection probably results not from direct physical effects of heat or cold on the nerve endings, but from chemical stimulation of the endings as modified by temperature. Coming to the neural pathway, the impulses from cold receptors are carried by A delta fibers, and those from the warm receptors are carried by C fibers to the dorsal horn. The fibers cross within the same segment of spinal cord and reach the lateral column of the same segment. From here, the second order neurons start and ascend upwards as lateral spinothalamic tract. In the CNS, the lateral spinothalamic tract carry impulses to the thalamus, and from there, थर्ड ऑर्डर न्यूरॉन स्टार्ट एंड फाइनली रीच द सोमेटोसेंसरी कॉर्टेक्स. सो दिस इज द पाथवे ऑफ टेम्परेचर. दिस इज सिमिलर टू द एंटीरियर स्पाइनोथैलेमिक ट्रैक्ट. सो डॉर्सल रूट गैंग्लियन इज द फर्स्ट ऑर्डर न्यूरॉन्स. दे रिलेट टू द स्पाइनल ग्रे हॉर्न. फ्रॉम हियर द सेकेंड ऑर्डर न्यूरॉन्स स्टार्ट and they cross to the other side, and finally they and these neurons are carried through the lateral funiculus. In the anterior spinothalamic tract they relay into the through the anterior funiculus, but here through the lateral funiculus. These fibers are carried through the lateral funiculus. This is the only difference. Otherwise, it is same as the anterior spinothalamic tract. So first order neuron, then second order neurons, then they will relay here. From here, the third order neurons will start, and finally, they will relay to the sensory cortex. Coming to proprioception, the position sensors are frequently also called proprioceptive sensors. They can be divided into two subtypes: static position sense, which means conscious perception of the orientation of the different parts of the body with respect to one another, and dynamic proprioception, also called kinesthesia or rate of movement sense. Okay, so static position sense and the dynamic position sense. So dynamic proprioception is also known as kinesthesia. That is, we feel the rate of movement through this kinesthesia. So basically, proprioception, through this sensation, we are aware of our body. Suppose where our finger is, where our leg is, or which joint we are moving, all these sensations are carried through the brain through the different receptors, and this mechanism, this sensation is the proprioception. That is, we are aware of our whole body, where a particular body part is situated, and if there is any movement in that part, what is the movement in our shoulder joint, what is the rate of movement. That is the kinesthesia we feel. And that sensation is the kinesthesia. The rate of movement or the dynamic proprioception is the kinesthesia. And the static position sense, that is the basic proprioception. Coming to the position sensory receptors. Knowledge of position, both static and dynamic, depends on knowing the degree of angulations of all joints in all planes and their rates of change. Therefore, multiple different types of receptors help to determine joint angulations and are used together for position sense. Skin tactile receptors, deep receptors near the joints, and muscle spindles are among the most important receptors. So you should remember what are the receptors for proprioception. They are skin tactile receptors, deep receptors near the joints, muscle spindles. Okay, muscle spindle is very important. Then at the extremes of joint angulation, stretch of the ligaments and deep tissues around the joint is an additional important factor in determining position. Types of sensory endings used for this are the Pacinian carpuscles, raphenous endings, and receptors similar to the Golgi tendon receptors. The Pacinian carpuscles and muscle spindles are specially adapted for detecting rapid rates of change. It is likely that these are the receptors most responsible for detecting rate of movement. Coming to the neural transmission, sensation from the receptors are carried by the myelinated nerve fibers group 1 and 2 in the peripheral nerves. Proprioception is carried by multiple pathways to the cerebellum mainly, and also to the cerebrum as follows. So there are different pathways through which the proprioceptive sensations are carried from the receptors to the cerebellum mainly, and also to the cerebrum. So what are the tracts? Let's see. First one is the tract of Gall and Burdock, or the dorsal lemniscal system. So this tract carry proprioception to the cerebral cortex for projection of conscious image of the body in space. Conscious sense of position is carried by axons from joint receptors and Pacinian corpuscles. This enter via posterior root and enter the dorsal column of the same side. From spinal cord, ultimately these sensations reach the somatic sensory cortex. The unconscious proprioceptive information arising from the muscle spindles, Golgi tendon organs, and joint receptors travel through group 1A and 1B fibers in peripheral nerves and through spinocerebellar tracts and dorsal column in the spinal cord. From the nuclei gracilis and cunctals, fibers concerned with unconscious proprioception reach the cerebellum as external arcuate fibers. Dorsal or posterior spinocerebellar tract. It is an uncrossed tract which arises from the ipsilateral Clark's column of cells and carries proprioceptive information from the limbs of the same side. It enters through the ipsilateral inferior cerebellar peduncle and is distributed to the spinocerebellum. It carries information from the muscle spindles, Golgi tendon organs, joint receptors, cutaneous receptor, etc., from the lower part of the body. Another tract is the anterior spinocerebellar tract. The fibers of this tract arise from the marginal cells in the dorsal gray horn of spinal cord. After taking origin, the fibers cross the midline and ascend in the opposite side. It carries the proprioceptive information from the limbs of the opposite side. It enters the cerebellum through superior cerebellar peduncle and is distributed to the lower limb area of the cortex of spinocerebellum. Another tract is the cunocerebellar tract. It arises from the accessory cuneate nucleus and carries proprioceptive impulses from the upper limb, upper trunk, and neck. It enters through ipsilateral inferior cerebellar peduncle and is distributed to the spinocerebellum. And another important tract is the rostral spinocerebellar tract. It originates in the upper part of the spinal cord and carries information from the upper part of the body to the cerebellum. So these are the different tracts which carry these proprioceptive sensations. So this diagram shows some of the important tracts which carry the proprioceptive sensation. So this is the ventral spinocerebellar tract or anterior spinocerebellar tract. Okay, then anterior spinocerebellar tract, then dorsal spinocerebellar tract or the posterior spinocerebellar tract. This is the posterior spinocerebellar tract, that is from spinal cord to the cerebellum. So these tracts carry information from the spinal cord to the cerebellum, anterior spinocerebellar and posterior spinocerebellar. Then cunocerebellar. This is the cunocerebellar tract. Okay, so these are the important tracts which carry the proprioceptive sensations. So today I have discussed the somatic sensations, important somatic sensations like touch, temperature, proprioception. The pain sensation will be told to you in another separate class. So you should know the different receptors which carry the different receptors of touch, and the receptors for, what are the receptors for temperature, what are the receptors for proprioception. At first you should know what are the receptors, then you have to know how these sensations are carried from the receptor to the brain, okay, to the sensory cortex, the whole pathway. You have to know the whole pathway, the first order neurons, second order neurons, third order neurons. And you should, whenever any tract comes in your exam, you have to draw the diagram. So this much for today. Thank you.